So today, the 15th lecture, we will be having design of feedback amplifiers in a systematic manner. In the last class, we had discussed negative feedback systems wherein output variation follows the input variation only if the loop gain is very large in negative feedback. Therefore, right, output follows the input at the point of feedback. Voltage follower and current follower were discussed and their application as buffers and regulators were pointed out. Phase follower and frequency follower also on similar lines were discussed, and the inversion property of the feedback in terms of FM detection and FSK application followed thereafter. Then we had seen that the lock range of feedback systems is the range over which loop gain is kept greater than, much greater than 1, and output follows the input at the feedback point, and that range, okay, is the static characteristic of the feedback system. How to evaluate that range in the case of amplifiers, in the case of transconductors and transresistor in the loop, in the case of frequency lock loop as lock range were discussed. Dynamic operation of the feedback system was then considered in terms of discussing the first order system and what is called as gain bandwidth product of the feedback system as a quality of measure of the feedback system dynamic response was also discussed. Q equal to 1 in a second order system for high speed operation of the feedback system was the ideal value of design of all such systems, whether it is FLL or an amplifier with unity gain or gain of K. That Q equal to 1 is the criteria for making it have minimum time taken for coming to steady state. Q equal to 1 over root 2 is considered as the best value for steady state response to be maximally flat. The earlier lecture, lecture 8 on nullator-norator concept, okay, in synthesis of ideal amplifiers facilitated the synthesis of topologies for voltage amplifiers, current amplifiers, transconductance amplifiers and transresistance amplifiers. These were actually indirectly, okay, feedback amplifiers because output is finite. And that's how nullator norator functions as a pair, and input to the nullator goes to 0. It is exactly similar to the control system, that is feedback system design, wherein the input to the system goes to 0, the error goes to 0, and output follows the input at the feedback point. Okay. So this is the same concept that is followed, okay, in synthesis of all these ideal amplifiers. Then the feedback has also been considered, okay, in network, two-port network theory as a parameter that comes, okay, of due to interaction of output variable with input. Now, that is what is going to be considered here, that feedback system in circuits will be discussed in terms of two port parameters. Feedback in systems presented earlier used ideal amplifiers, unilateral amplifiers, and even the feedback was unilateral. Here the feedback network is a bilateral network in circuits that we are likely to use, and that is what is going to be considered in today's lecture. So let us get on to what are ideal amplifiers. This is just a revision of what has already been discussed earlier in two-port theory. So signal sources cannot deliver directly power to the load, because that power that is generated by the signal source is normally very, very low. So a power amplification is resorted to by amplifiers. Amplification is required to enhance the signal power. Amplification is one of the major signal processing activity in analog. And there are different types of amplifiers dealing with different power levels. So the ones which are dealing directly with sensor input, okay, are the called pre-amplifiers. These are the pre-amplifiers which deal with low power levels. They can be tuned, that means they can have a selective circuit at the input so as to reject the noise outside the band and select only the signal based on the signal bandwidth. So they are called tuned amplifiers. So at the filtering is a major operation of improving the signal to noise ratio right at the input, okay. And power amplifiers deal with, again they may be tuned, okay, so or wideband amplifiers, and there the efficiency of delivery of power matters. So based on different criteria we have to make these designs. However, the basic amplifiers are four types based on input and output variables: voltage control voltage source, voltage control current source, current control voltage source, current control current source. But commonly these are called voltage amplifiers, transconductance amplifiers, transresistance amplifiers and current amplifiers. Now what is the criteria for division of these two, these four? We have discussed this in the earlier lecture, however let us repeat that. Okay, this we have already discussed. Pre-amplifiers deal with low power. Enhancing signal to noise ratio is the primary objective of this. Power amplifiers deal with signal levels which are pretty high, okay, and efficiency is the primary consideration. Ideal amplifiers have zero input power and deliver finite output power. That can be done two ways. One is Vi can be 0, which is primarily called Vi equal to 0, means this is primarily having current as the input variable, so current control, and Ii equal to 0 means this is voltage control, voltage is the input variable. At the output they can be current source or voltage source. So we have the four types of ideal amplifiers: ideal current source or ideal voltage source. So ideal current source means output impedance is infinity, ideal voltage source means output impedance is 0. Now the types of amplifiers in terms of commercial availability for active devices: op amps, MOSFETs, JFETs, BJTs. We have understood the basic functioning of all these devices. These were introduced earlier, and these are devices which mainly use MOSFETs and BJTs and JFETs, okay. So these are basically circuits which have already been designed and biased automatically when you use dual supply or single supply, whereas these require special care to bias these devices, and therefore these discrete circuits made out of these are now becoming very rare in major applications of analog circuits, and ICs have dominated the scene. Types of amplifiers: operational amplifiers itself are available as operational voltage amplifier, operational current amplifier, operational transconductance amplifier, operational transresistance amplifiers. These are all designed for a variety of applications and made available. These are the major manufacturers of op amps and most of the analog ICs, Texas Instruments, National Semiconductor, Analog Devices, Linear Technologies, Maxim, Intersil, etc. Non-idealities of op amps. The primary non-idealities are finite DC gain, finite bandwidth, finite gain bandwidth product. This is most important of all, right? So, in the dynamic operation of most of these op amps, what matters is primarily the gain bandwidth product of the device that decides the quality of the op amp. Offset voltages and currents, offset drifts. More than offset voltages and currents, the drift of these voltages and currents with temperature is causing a signal at very, very low frequency, and therefore, when one is dealing with very low frequency signal, these matter a lot. It becomes difficult to isolate. This noise, okay, matters, okay, a lot in terms of interfering with signal. Finite input impedance and output impedance, okay. So, these are the secondary non-idealities. Slew rate, this is one of the most important non-ideality in power sort of output of the integrated circuit, okay. That means, what is the power bandwidth of a system that is decided primarily by slew rate, that is the maximum rate at which output is capable of rising. Current and voltage limitations, obviously, voltage limitation comes about due to power supply used, and current limitation comes about due to the device having a maximum power handling ability. Finite common mode rejection ratio is an important aspect of design of a front end of most of these stages, okay, where differential input signal is facilitating rejection of common mode noise and acceptance of differential mode signal. So, that is one way of improving the signal to noise ratio straight away. Parameter dependence on temperature and supply voltage are the main causes of these variations interfering with design, and therefore, any design should therefore, have the design independent of the active parameters that vary with temperature and supply voltage. These are typically some of the popular op amps. 741, where everybody knows about this op amp. It is having a gain bandwidth product of about megahertz, input impedance of about 1 mega ohm, output impedance of few hundreds of ohms, and a slew rate of 1 volt per microsecond. And TL 747 is a dual op amp. TL 081 is unlike this 741, which is bipolar input. This is a FET input stage, and therefore, it has a higher slew rate. It is about 13 volts per microsecond and a bandwidth of gain bandwidth product of 3 megahertz. This is single, dual and quad. Now, like that, there are a variety of op amps made available, and most important, I would like to mention that these are compensated to operate from unity gain to higher gains, whereas this is uncompensated. So, when one is deciding to make it operate even for the unity gain, what happens is it has been made to have a Q of 1 at that point of time in its dynamic operation, whereas for higher gain it is sluggish. Whereas, depending upon the gain for which you are designing the op amp, you can use 748, which is exactly similar to 741, but for the fact that compensating capacitor is not put internally, it can be compensated externally. That means the design can work as Q equal to 1 for any higher gain that you are using it for. So, this is a better proposition, okay, than these compensated op amps in actual design. So, parameters of TL081, you have whatever I have mentioned here. You can note that the offset voltage is 20 millivolts This is typically the kind of offset voltage with FET input stages, whereas bipolar input has typically 2 to 3 millivolts as input offset. Laser timed matching of resistors can improve the order of offset by one order of magnitude further, but then they become costly processes. Feedback in two port active networks. Now consider this, that a general two port network in Y parameters. This YI is the self admittance, YR is the component coming from output voltage back to the input as current. This is the feedback. So feedback has already been touched in networks courses for you in terms of two port parameters. And this is the feed forward, VI gets transferred to the output as VI into YF, and this is the self admittance at the output, and you are going to connect a load at this point. Okay, there may be a source shunt admittance here. So effectively you can have these parameters getting modified by source and load admittances, that you can have YS of the source and YL of the load, modifying these parameters as YS plus YL, and this then becomes IS, where IS is the source current. So that is in general how you represent the Y parameters. And you can look at this, that input VI gets transferred to output as current and appears as YF into VI, and that flows through this load of Y0 plus YL, so develops a voltage V0 which is minus YF VI by Y0 plus YL. So you can see the forward voltage gain therefore becomes minus YF by Y0 plus YL. Then this output voltage comes back to the input as YR, okay, and develops an output voltage of YR minus, therefore it becomes plus, into YI plus YS. So this particular thing can be considered in general as loop gain equal to GL. We will term this always as loop gain. This is got by taking the determinant of the matrix. What is the determinant? This into this minus this into this. So YIA plus YS into YOA plus YL minus YFA YRA. So this is something that you can take out, then rest of it YIA plus YS into YOA plus YL into 1 minus GL. That means determinant of this matrix is product of these two into 1 minus GL. So let us remember that the determinant of the matrix is product of these total self admittances at the input and the output and into 1 minus GL. So let us now consider feedback in two port active networks. If the two port network is an active device which is assumed to be unilateral, the reverse transfer parameter YRA has to go to 0. So we are using an amplifier with YRA equal to 0. Then rest of the parameters YIA, YOA are finite and small compared to YFA. YFA is the large factor, okay, transferring something from the input to the output. Input voltage is converted to output current. So all the Y parameters of the active device are sensitive to temperature, time, bias voltage, supply voltage, and have poor manufacturing tolerances. Using a suitable passive network, two port network, with the active device, it is possible to make the resultant system as an ideal amplifier. Let us see how we can mathematically achieve this, right, and then realize it physically. So, we have the ideal amplifier, okay, shunted at the input and shunted at the output by a passive network, because these are all short circuit parameters. The moment I short this or this, the feed passive network gets separated from the active network, okay. So, the total system now has Y admittance, which is summation of the Y admittance of the amplifier with the Y admittance of the feedback network. That is how we can modify a feedback amplifier system, okay, the ideal amplifier coupled with the passive feedback network. So, YIP, YRP, YRP, YOP are the feedback Y parameters of the passive network. YFA is much greater than YRP and YRA is 0. These are the things which are known to us. So, now composite Y parameter of this network is going to have the currents adding at the input port, currents adding at the output port, forming the resultant current II at the input and I naught at the output. The voltage is common both at the input and the output, okay, for both the networks. So, Y parameters of amplifier network add with Y parameter of the feedback network this way. Now, this feedback is now totally determined by this passive network, and the feed forward is totally determined by the active network. This is close to a very small value compared to this, or that is how you have to select the feedback network, so that this dominates. Then let us see what happens. Admittances increase in the input port as well as the output port. Admittances increase means impedances decrease. That means at the input it becomes current control by the modification, and at the output it becomes a voltage source, and that is what we want to have, current control voltage source as the design. That means it is possible to have this going towards 0, this going towards 0, this going towards 0 in the inverted Y matrix of the composite network, and this is the one Z. And Z has to become independent of the parameters of the active device. Let us see whether it happens when we invert the Y matrix of this composite network. So, this is the inverted matrix, Y matrix, here represented in this manner. Total admittance at the input is YIA, YIP plus YS. Total admittance at the output is YOA plus YOP plus YL, and this is dominated by YRP alone, and this is dominated by YFA. Now, inverted, it results in this divided by determinant of the matrix minus of this divided by determinant. So, everything gets reduced by the factor decided by the determinant of the matrix. So, that means a modification of the element values of the matrix take place here. Now, that determinant is equal to this into this minus this into this. So, if now as pointed out earlier, this into this divided by this into this we have defined as loop gain. Please remember this. This has been defined as loop gain GL. So, if GL is negative, it is negative feedback. If GL is positive, it is positive feedback. So, this is the best way of identifying whether it is negative feedback that you are adopting or not. So, if GL is negative, that is what is considered now, it is negative feedback. And magnitude of GL must be much greater than 1. for us to have effective feedback. So, under that situation, the determinant of the matrix can be approximated as this alone, because this by this is much greater than 1. So, this is the resultant determinant, and that modifies all these element values. So, let us write down the element values, modified element values. Everywhere we will see that this is what happens, that y of a gets cancelled. That means the forward transfer parameter of the composite network is now totally decided by the passive network, 1 by YRP. It is 1 by G2, what we discussed in system design, 1 by YRP, inverse of the feedback factor of the passive network. And all other 3 elements are reduced by y of a, which is huge, and therefore they go towards 0. And that is what we are proving, that this now becomes a current control voltage source with a transfer parameter totally independent of the active device and the load, okay, and the source emittances. And this is the network now, okay, making use of an op amp. This is RIA, input impedance. This is ROA, output impedance of the op amp. This is the voltage gain. Typically, a DC gain is 10 to power 5 to 10 to power 6. RIA is 1 mega ohm, ROA is 100 ohm. Let us consider a problem with RS as 10k, RL as 1k load, RF as 1k, because let us say we pose a problem saying that I want to design a current control voltage source or trans impedance amplifier with the trans impedance matrix as 0, 0, 0 and minus 1k. So, that means actually I have to use feedback resistance, the passive network between input and output, which is 1k. Okay. So, in which case let us see what happens. 1 over 1k or 1 millisiemens, okay, is the y parameter of this. I will indicate it here in terms of y composite Z matrix of this current control voltage source, 1 over RIA for the amplifier, 1 over RF due to the feedback resistance, 1 over RS due to the source, all the self admittances appearing at the input when the output is shorted, and this is 1 over ROA, 1 over RF and 1 over RL at the output when the input is shorted. And the amplifier network, composite network, feeds from Vi to the output A times Vi, a current which is A times Vi divided by ROA, current coming into the port, and therefore is positive. So, that is the Y parameter of the amplifier that is used, and due to the feedback network, okay, there is a feed forward of minus 1 by RF. When Vi is applied, Vi by RF flows out. So, similarly, when V naught is applied and input is shorted, Vi by RF flows again out. So, there is a negative this thing. So, effectively inversion of this results in the modified matrix Z parameter, which is minus RF as desired. It is totally independent of A, ROA, RIA, and we have the input impedance which is RF by A going towards 0 into small factor here, and again output impedance RF by A going towards 0 again multiplied by a small factor, and the reverse transmission is reduced considerably, 1 over A, ROA. So, this if A is made large, all these three factors go towards 0. And the loop gain is GL equal to minus A divided by 1 plus some small factor and a small factor here, okay. And therefore, this has to be in magnitude much greater than 1, okay. And it has a negative sign indicating it is negative feedback, and the determinant of this matrix is A by RORF, okay. So, mathematically it is understood very neatly as this. A problem has been solved here. So, design a trans resistance amplifier with a Z matrix which is 0, 0, 0 and minus 1 k. This is the design problem. For a source resistance of 10 k, RS is 10 k and load resistance of 1 kilo ohm. Consider an op amp with input impedance of 1 mega ohm, voltage gain of 10 to the power 6 and output impedance of 100 ohms, typically similar to 741. The op amp is represented by its Y matrix, 1 over 1 mega ohm, 1 microsecond. This is 1 over RIA, this is 1 over ROA, which is 10 millisiemens, 1 over 100 ohms. Okay, 0 here, no unilateral, no feedback, and this is nothing but A by ROA positive. A is 10 to the power 6, ROA 1 over ROA, that is 1 by 100. So, it is 10 to the power 4 Siemens. Added to the feedback passive network, which is 1 millisiemens, 1 millisiemens, minus 1 millisiemens, minus 1 millisiemens. That is the network that we have considered here, RF between input and output port. So, one has, if you put 1 k here, you get 1 millisiemens, 1 millisiemens, minus 1 millisiemens, minus 1 millisiemens as the Y parameters of this feedback network that gets added to this along with the source and the load, and then inverted, the Z matrix now becomes 1.2 milli ohms, 0.11 milli ohms, 0.1 milli ohms. See how close to 0 it is compared to the RF, which is 1 k, which is the forward transmission that has occurred. So, current controlled voltage source, okay, with input impedance of 1.2 milli ohms, output impedance of 0.11 milli ohms, and that voltage source converts the current by this factor 1 k. So, this is the transfer impedance. So, this is the complete design. So, this is the mathematical part of it. You can see that the loop gain is very high compared to 1. Actually, it has to be indicated that this is minus, okay. So, this is getting multiplied by this divided by this. Okay. So, this is the final network, RF is equal to 1 k, RL is equal to 1 k, this is 10 ohms, 10 kilo ohms, and IS into RF is the forward output voltage with a negative sign, because this IS now flows through this totally, because this is a nullator, remember. And therefore, the current flows through this, this voltage at the output is simply IS into RF. So, using this concept of nullator, we have already synthesized this structure. And now, the mechanism of how this gets altered because of A, RI and RO has been demonstrated by taking the two port network and by using the appropriate parameters for this. So, how do we apply this technique in general to any of these four? That means, we have to take recourse to impedance matrix. The ideal amplifier that is to be realized, that should have the transfer parameter alone becoming independent of the active device, okay, that is PF here, and these three parameters becoming 0. PF is finite and is the chosen design parameter, should be independent of parameters of the active device used. So, let us see how it can be in general dealt with. So, I am considering an amplifier, appropriate amplifier with PIA finite, POA finite, 0 as the reverse transmission and PFA very large. PFA is very large. All the 3 elements of the emittance matrix have poor manufacturing tolerances, can vary widely with temperature, time and bias supply voltage. Then I couple it with a passive network which is having its own parameter getting added, PIP, PRP, PFP, POP. The distinction being that PFP is small compared to PFA, and these 2 are same in magnitude and may be opposite in sign, depend in H and D, and same in sign in Z and Y. Now, it gets modified by the determinant of this matrix in its inverse. So, the input and output variables interchange, okay, because of inversion, okay, and this is the inverted matrix, and we have here the inverted matrix written in terms of delta. Delta is the determinant of the matrix, which is this into this minus this into this. So, it can be written as this into 1 minus GL. That is what has been done in the next step. So, once you do that, you get this inverted matrix as composite inverted matrix as 1 by PIA plus PIP into 1 minus GL, 1 by POA plus POP into 1 minus GL, and minus PRP divided by this into 1 minus GL. So, all these terms are affected by 1 minus GL. And since loop gain is very much greater, it is negative and much greater than 1 in magnitude, what happens is that it is primarily very much greater than 1 by PFA, and therefore this PFA is a large quantity, okay, is going to be affected only by GL here, okay, and you therefore have only the reverse transmission of the passive network coming as the forward transmission of the feedback network. And here all these things are going towards 0. So, 1 minus GL is the factor by which all the things get modified suitably to reach the idealization, corresponding idealization. So, for available active device, okay, choose a suitable passive device and combine this to together suitably to form the ideal amplifier design that you desire. After inverting, you get this modification. So, in conclusion, design of feedback amplifier involves the following activities. Right? So, the voltage amplifier, the topology of voltage amplifier, let us consider what should happen. Actually, you have an active device block. How will you connect it? You will connect so that it becomes voltage control. That means actually it should be connected in series because impedances should increase, right? And it becomes a voltage source at the output. This is a voltage controlled voltage source. So, it should be having output impedance decreasing. That is possible only by shunting. So, this is the topological arrangement for a voltage controlled voltage source. That means this is easily going to be a modified element of the matrix by shorting the thing here, okay, and opening the thing here, the parameters add. They are coming in series here, okay, and in shunt at the output. So, that is easily done if you use H parameter, that is, okay, things in series add at the, because the impedance HI is impedance. So, HI adds, okay, it is a short circuit parameter, and HO adds, okay, when it is shunted. It is an admittance. Okay. So you have feedback, okay, where H parameters add. So I call it H feedback. So this feedback tells us that H parameters add, and the inverted H is the ideal amplifier parameter, that is G parameter. So this is called H feedback, and the matrix that is aimed for is the inversion of H, and that is the G matrix. That is what becomes 0, 0, 0 and then the GF. And the modifying factor is due to the loop gain. Okay. So the loop gain is to be made much greater than 1 is the criteria for this. It should be negative. The current control current source is the current amplifier, wherein we start with a topology where in order to make it current control, it should be the dual of this. That means it should be shunt at the input. This is for voltage control, voltage source, current control, current source, it should be shunt at the input and series at the output. So amplifier and feedback. So actually G parameters add here, and current control means the impedance should decrease here, and current source means impedance should increase here. So it should be series here and shunt here. So you have G parameters adding. So we call it G feedback to achieve current control current source ideal, and its parameters are represented by HF ideal H parameter. Okay. Similarly, if I want a transconductance amplifier, transconductance means voltage control current source. I start with voltage control means actually I should have things in series, so that it becomes voltage control, impedances increase, and current source it should be in series at the output. So series at the input and series at the output, that is Z feedback I call it. Z parameters add because it is coming in series at the input and series, right, it is open circuit parameter. So series at the input and series at the output, and it is converted to Y parameter, and ideal Y parameter will become this. Okay. So this is the amplifier, this is the passive network. So this is for voltage controlled current source. The dual of that is current control current source, where both at the input and the output it should be in shunt, so that the input impedance decreases, output impedance decreases because it is a voltage source at the output, because it is current controlled here, right. So we have amplifier feedback network. So this is current control voltage source. So these are the topologies which naturally emerge, and this is the most appropriate name for this. Okay. Because the parameters add, it is easy to modify the parameters. Okay. And add here G parameter adds, Z parameter adds, Y parameter adds, and you convert this Y to Z and you get 0, 0 and ZF as the ideal parameter. Okay. In the next lecture, we shall be discussing the design of the, we have already discussed the design of current controlled, let us say I think this is current controlled voltage source. So this has been already discussed, as starting from Y parameters, we have obtained the desired Z parameters. So we have this one, okay, and this one and this one in that order. Voltage control voltage source, that is voltage amplifier, has to be discussed. So we will start with the H parameters adding and invert it and get the G parameter, composite G parameter. And when you get the composite G parameter, you will simultaneously get to know the output, okay, input conductance, output impedance, okay, as also the transfer parameter, exactly how close it is to the ideal value. That is decided by how high loop gain is, okay, compared to 1. So, the error is 1 over loop gain. That is the error in the transfer function that you are designing. That means higher the loop gain, better is the approximation to the idealized value. So, this is the effect of negative feedback. Now, the same thing can be discussed also in terms of device op amp being replaced by transistors. For example, if instead of the op amp that is being used as the active device, transistor is used, just take the MOSFET. So, this is nothing but let us say consider, you can treat it as a voltage controlled already because it is open circuit here. Let us say this is Vi and you get Gm times Vi as the small signal change in current at the output here. So, we have that flowing through its own output impedance, which is let us say 1 over GdS, okay, is going to cause the gain to be minus, okay, Gm by GdS. That is the value of the gain. That means minus A equals to this minus Gm by GdS. So, it is equivalent to an op amp, okay, that is having a gain of Gm by GdS, A, right. So, you can incorporate in the feedback network appropriately, so as to get a current amplifier or a voltage amplifier or anything of that sort. So, one way to do it is just to sort of have, let us say, full current fed back to the input. We have already discussed this or synthesized this structure in the MOSFET, okay, when the full output current is fed back to the input, the current gain is 1. That is the diode connected MOSFET. Now, the loop gain in this case is, since full current is fed back to the input, okay, you can treat it as Vi as input, Gm by GdS as the output voltage fed back in the direction, so that it is minus A, okay, which is fed back to the input. So, the loop gain is A, right, in negative feedback. So, the actual gain of this, current gain or voltage gain, has to be, okay, 1 by 1 plus 1 over A. So, that is the gain, and A being equal to Gm by GdS. So, this is a very simple single MOSFET current amplifier with gain equal to 1, which has a loop gain of Gm by GdS. Just like we do it in the case of op amps, it can be done in the case of FETs and bipolar transistors, okay. However, this can be postponed to IC design, okay. At system level, it is better to use near ideal devices as active devices, and op amps are the best ones, okay, which will have least amount of parasitics coming into picture, okay, in causing deviation. Not only that, in an op amp, you can create a structure with high loop gain, okay, whereas in the case of a transistor, it is limited to Gm by GdS, which is not going to be very high. So, most of the understanding of feedback and its effect can be well illustrated using op amps instead of the bipolar transistor or field effect transistor. And these single transistor devices are very rarely used in system design. Okay, and ready-made ICs are made available to you, okay, which can work very well, okay, up to very high frequencies today.